Welcome to yet another surgeonar, that is the live surgery demonstration from Dr. Grewal's center, that is Grewal Eye Institute, Chandigarh. And it is my privilege to introduce Dr. S.P.S. Grewal, who is a stalwart in the field of ophthalmology. He is the founder and managing director of Grewal Eye Institute at Chandigarh, India. He did his fellowship at Moorfields Eye Hospital, UK, and with an interest in teaching, he was an associate professor at Postgraduate Institute of Chandigarh. He holds faculty position in Feinberg School of Medicine, Department of Ophthalmology, Northwestern University, USA. He was awarded Colonel Rangachari Gold Medal for the best research paper in 1989. He has more than 150 scientific publications, awards, presentations, papers, video presentations across national, international conferences, and many firsts to his credit. He has received numerous awards at international and national level, including the International Scholar Award by the American Academy of Ophthalmology. He has an extensive experience in all types of cataract and refractive surgery, and he primarily focuses on the premium cataract surgery, including flax and advanced refractive laser procedures. And he's been involved with more than 500 CAMs and more than 4,000 underprivileged patients which have been operated by him. And it is, sir, a privilege for us to have you on the surgeonar today. And over to the Grewal Eye Institute, Chandigarh, for the live surgical demonstration of LRIs as well as toric IOL implantation.
Good evening, Dr. Namrata and Dr. Rajesh, and good evening to all the viewers. And we'll be starting the surgery immediately. First, a brief introduction about what the case is and what the parameters are will be discussed. Our highlight for today is managing cases with astigmatism. As you know, that the commonest question asked in the post-operative period after a successful surgery is, "Doc, I still have to wear glasses." So that is the situation where once we have mastered the spherical component, we move on to take care of the astigmatism so that the patients can have a good unaided vision. Over to Sataj for the description of the first case. I'll drape the case and
complain of diminution of vision in both the eyes. Best corrected visual acuity in the left eye was 6/12. Patient underwent refractive surgery, LASIK, about 12 years back. Biometry was done, optical with IOL Master 700, and TrueK was used to calculate the IOL power along with the toric. Even pentacam was performed, and the holiday EKR readings that we had at 1, 2, 3, and 4 millimeter zones were then used with the Barrett toric calculator to see what was the difference between all the four zones. We decided to go ahead with the reading we were getting from the 2 millimeter zone. So the patient has been planned for phacoemulsification with a toric IOL implantation in the left eye. The keratometry values at the 2 millimeter zone were 38.82 at 39 degrees and 39.96 at 129 degrees. The IOL power selected is a 19 diopter Technis toric ZCT150 and has to be rotated to 134 degrees.
Hi, Sataj. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
So, Sartaj, can you tell us something about the IOL power calculation in post-LASIK eyes?
Yes, ma'am. In post-LASIK eyes, if post-myopic LASIK, we always, even if you go with what is available with the biometer, with Barrett, it tends to be fairly accurate, but it is always prudent to go ahead and use the Ascaris Barrett post-refractive calculator, which gives you a minimum, mean, and maximum value. Again, depending on the pre-LASIK values that you have, it's again a little better to lean towards the maximum value that you get, which is what we have done in this case. Even though the IOL Master was giving us about 17 diopters, the Ascaris online calculator was actually saying something closer to 19 diopters for the spherical equivalent. So that is what we have chosen.
Okay.
And in terms of toric calculator, you always prefer Barrett calculator these days?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Sorry. We prefer to go ahead with the Barrett calculator. Even the one that comes in combined with the IOL Master 700 TrueK is very accurate, but it is still prudent to always double check the values with different gravimetry readings on the online calculator also.
Okay, can we come to the surgical video?
Microscope view.
I think this is a microscope view, and the needle, the cystotome is being made for the...
Okay, is the view clear now, ma'am?
Very clear.
Absolutely.
Very clear.
So I'll be starting with making two side ports. And then I'll be reforming the, I'll be injecting viscoelastic.
So the patient has already been marked on a slit lamp prior to surgery for the...
Yes, you can see the 1, 2, 3, 4 marks. The horizontal and the vertical meridian have been marked.
And you will be using the Callisto system. What system you are using for the toric alignment, sir?
We'll be doing both. Exercise 106. 134. So... This is the axis marked for the final rotation of the lens. This will be the final position for the implant. I'll start with the capsulotomy now.
So you normally make the capsulotomy through the side port?
Yes, I make it through the side port because I avoid going through the main incision, and I'll make the main incision after doing the capsulotomy. Because otherwise, if the main incision is made and you're doing capsulotomy, there are chances of the viscoelastic going out, and then AC becomes a little shallow, and then that will deform the shape of the anterior capsule, and you don't get that much control on that. And if you see here, can you see this mark here? This is from the previous LASIK, the edge of the flap.
Yes. And which viscoelastic do you normally use to do your capsular excisor?
I use methyl cellulose.
Okay.
Because with the Helon, there is a chance that if it starts coming out, most of it will come out. So my standard will be to use methyl cellulose for capsulotomy and to use Helon for IOL insertion, because with that the removal of the viscoelastic is complete and quick. So I'll be now doing hydrodissection. I'll stent the anterior capsule, make sure it is separated over a little wider area, give a single push, and then press a little bit at the diagnostic cockpit, and you could see the fluid wave coming here.
Yes.
That makes it sure that the fibers on this side are also separated from the capsule. And then the hydro delineation, again single wave, and you have the hydro delineation done.
So is this a special type of hydro dissection cannula, or is it a...
No, it's a special type cannula. It is not a straight edge, if you see.
The edge was looking a little different, that's edge, why.
And it is designed so that when I lift the anterior capsule, it gives you a wave which is very thin but very wide, and it spreads very quickly, and it goes into a plane between the capsule and the lens fibers. So it gives you a very good delineation plan. If you have a needle with a straight tip in front of it, then it is very difficult to create a broader beam.
Yeah.
And if a little bit of the fluid goes into the lens fibers, you don't get the right plan.
Mm-hmm.
So at this stage, I would like to re-inject visco with the purpose that if there are a little bit lens matter fibers, they go out, the capsule goes out, and it is AC is formed again. So we go on to now the phaco part. At any stage, there is some issue with centration, please just prompt
me for that. Surely. Sure.
So I would like to remove the apicortex plate here so that I have a better judgment of the nucleus, and I'll first do the sculpting and then I'll engage it and try to break into two equal halves and make sure that they are separated. Put some saline. Done. So it is divided into two parts. So this will be engaging and breaking for the first fragment. Now I change into the phaco two position. So take out the first fragment.
So which machine are you using, sir? Signature?
I'm using Signature Pro.
Signature Pro. That's right. And what's the phaco power that has been set for this nucleus?
So Taj, can you read it out, please, from the screen?
So I think 45. Okay. So I think myopes generally have a harder cataract than what their red glow suggests. So the red glow was very good, and it's not that soft also as the red glow was suggesting. It's grade 2 to say grade 3, and again...
So we have been able to remove the nucleus and then the cortical plate. And we'll now go to irrigation aspiration, and I'll be using bimanual for this case.
Is it for this case, or your preferred method is bimanual or coaxial?
Okay, I prefer to use coaxial in most of the cases.
Mm-hmm.
And those cases where I'm doing flax, those are the cases where I'll be using bimanual. I think both bimanual or coaxial, both are equally good.
Yeah.
There are some situations where the coaxial better. There are some situations where bimanual will be better. So I think you need both in your armamentarium, and then you should be good and proficient in using
both of them.
Yes.
Absolutely.
It will be very difficult to say that A is better than B.
Absolutely.
And sir, this, of course, case shows a classical breathing pupil of a myope, where every time you go in, the pupil dilates, and every time you come out, the iris lens diaphragm is a little labile, so it sort of mid-dilates. But what brand of irrigation aspiration, sir, were you using?
I think we are using the BSS from Appaswamy, am I right? I think it's BSS from Appaswamy.
Okay.
I'll just confirm it also.
Okay.
So this is the lens that we are going to use.
Johnson & Johnson
single piece Technis Toric. And you can see here, these are the marks on both the sides, which will be finely aligned. I tuck in the loops. I prevent tucking the loops like this. I would keep them very close to the edge of the optic here. In that situation, the loops will not touch each other, and their chances of sticking to each other are minimized.
Yeah. I think in terms of rotation, there was a study which was done by David Chang, and he clearly showed that the Technis lenses, in terms of the rotation, they are supposed to be more stable, the toric lenses.
Yeah, stability in the toric lenses is not an issue. Like wherever I had two situations in the last 1 year where I had to redial the toric, and in both the cases, when I reviewed the videos, it was at the end of the surgery. I thought I finished the surgery and trying to remove the drape, that is the time when the rotation occurred. And if your placement is absolutely accurate, I don't see any reason why the lens should rotate in the post-op period except for the first 5 to 7 minutes. In the bag, in a lens which is implanted inside the bag, there are no tangential forces occurring on the lens which can rotate the lens. The lens will rotate only if there are forces occurring, which can occur if there is a shallowing of the anterior chamber in the immediate post-op period. So if your alignment is good and your wound is watertight and it doesn't leak, the chances of lens rotating are minimal.
Sir, please carry on.
What I'm doing is I'm placing the lens with the marks which are a little anti-clock to this. I'll wait for some time for the lens to open up, and you have to be a little careful about these small tiny air bubble dots which are there, and try to focus only onto the, sometimes the bubbles placed radially close to the edge may be confused as if they are the marks for the lens.
Marks themselves, yeah.
You use the new system, sir, for injecting the lens, the screw one.
The injector was a push injector or a screwing injector?
No, it's a screw injector. That is my favorite, because this gives me much more control, and I use the screw type. So at this stage, now the lens has opened up. So I'll go in now, and now I'm using a coaxial. I'll go in, tap the lens, press it down, and then remove the viscoelastic. So this will hold the lens in position. So the lens hasn't rotated much during the removal of the viscoelastic. Then I go and try to do the final manipulations here. Now once I'm on the axis, then I'll reform the anterior chamber very slowly. And once the AC is formed, then I'll reconfirm. If now the alignment is absolutely fine,
bang on the marks.
Clearly.
Yeah, if the alignment is not proper, then again, I'll go back, realign it and reform the AC. And I think this step or this stage of the surgery is very important to make sure that the AC is formed, to make sure that there is no leakage. And the drape has to be removed very slowly so that it doesn't pull onto the lids, which can press on the eye, therefore leading to little leakage of the fluid at this moment. So this is the end of the surgery now, well-centered. Capsular axis is covering the lens all around, and the axis is perfectly placed.
So there's a question by Dr. Pranav Ranjan, and he says that will the axis marking after completing phaco and before IOL insertion make any difference to the way you mark the lens?
Just 1 minute.
Yeah.
There is some issue, connectivity issue.
When I'm using the manual marking, I would first have the markings done, the meridian markings done before the patient is draped, and I'll do the markings right in the beginning of the surgery, because that is the time when the contour of the eye and everything is close to normal. and the corneal surface is okay, you don't have to again reform the AC, bring the pressure to a little normal, and then do the markings. So I this is the practice I have been following to do it again. I don't know what will be the added voltage to mark it at a later stage. In this case, the marks at the limbus were marked about 10 to 12 minutes earlier. So once you put the marks, they stay on the cornea for a fairly long time, and under the microscope, they are clearly visible.
Absolutely.
Absolutely, sir. And there's another question. Dr. Gati wants to know, what is the stability of toric IOLs in high myopes? Because they tend to have bigger back. So what do you think? Would they rotate or?
A very good question. Again, the lens will rotate if there is a tangential force working on the lens. Irrespective of the size of the eye, once the lens is in position and you are sure that there will be no shallowing of the AC and there will be no leakage of the fluid in the first 15 to 20 minutes after surgery, there is no theoretically and based on the physics principle, there is no rotational force acting on the lens which will. It is only if the AC shallow, the lens is pulled forwards, and that forward vector forces, part of the component of those vector forces will act tangentially and move the lens. If you leave it watertight and the wound is not leaking and it will not leak in the next 5 to 10 minutes, I don't see any reason why any lens will rotate. Even if the bag is very big, the lens is small, even then it will not rotate.
There's a question from Dr. Anand. He wants to know, what's the best time for LRI for good results?
What is the best time?
For LRI for good results.
Okay. If the question is that what is the best indication for LRI, then LRI will be done if the astigmatism is less than 1 diopter. If it is 1 diopter or more, my preferred choice will be to go in for the toric implant. And for 0.5, 0.7 cylinder, the LRIs are really important if you are doing multifocal or EDOF or trifocal lenses, because these are the lenses where you want dead emmetropia. You don't want to leave any residual cylindrical number in trifocal or multifocal or EDOF lenses so that they get the best unaided distant visual acuity.
So can we move to the next case now?
Sure. I'll just drape the case. Meantime, Sataj will be briefing about the data about the case.
Yes.
Our next patient is a 35-year-old female. She's a case of lupus nephritis and has developed a steroid-induced cataract. On PentaCam, she has astigmatism, and at the 3 millimeter zone, it is about 2 diopters. And in this patient, even on the IOL master, we were getting a slightly higher reading of 3 diopters. We decided to go ahead with the reading from the PentaCam at 3 millimeters and use the Barrett online calculator, which suggested implanting a ZCT 2.25 diopters at the IOL plane, and a 20.5 diopter spherical equivalent. So the patient has been planned for right eye phaco emulsification with a toric IOL and a 20.5 diopter Technis toric ZCT 225, which has to be rotated to 98 degrees. And in this case, we will be using the Zeiss Callisto platform.
So you'll be doing it, you'll be using Callisto here?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. You'll have to adjust the monitor so that they can show it at the end.
I think we are seeing a sticker of the phaco toric, the patient's name on it and the date and the surgeon's name on it.
Yeah. This is how we mark the videos for each case.
Okay.
Okay. So this is the whole of the list is printed in this format.
Okay.
So that's just right. Before that, we will start the recording, have the sticker, so that later on there is no confusion that
okay.
which patient this video belongs to.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
I think that's a great idea. Yeah. So it's like a record number and the sticker which is on the file.
Date, yes. The name of the surgeon, the procedure, the date, the registration number, all are there.
This is a posterior, classic posterior subcapsular cataract, steroid induced.
And can we go on to the Callisto screen now, please? Is it changed to camera now?
I think external camera will have to be shown.
Yeah, can someone switch on the external camera, please? Onto the screen.
And I think these automated marking systems have made a lot of difference. Absolutely. In the way we do our toric surgeries, because you don't have to mark them now. Yeah. If you have these instruments, whether it is, you know, Callisto or it is Baryon,
light dekho.
Makes a lot of difference.
Good.
Lovely.
Yes, please. So that is how the Callisto picks up the images.
We are not at the Callisto screen yet. We are just seeing the surgical microscope. So can somebody shift to Callisto, please? The external camera. The transmission is exceptionally good. I mean, we can see everything extremely clearly.
Is it coming now?
No, it's not.
So only the surgical view is coming, the eye. Yeah, so now it is coming. Yeah. Now it is coming. We can see it now.
So you can see the Callisto view. Yeah, and there are two rings. One is the blue circular ring, which is the limbus, which is the limbus marking. And then you have a yellow line, which is the axis marking. This is the horizontal axis. So once this is done, now we will start with the surgery. We'll switch off the Callisto at the moment, and then we'll have this view once we are to put the lenses.
And I think Callisto also not only helps in marking your toric IOL lens axis, but also helps in the centration of the lens.
Absolutely.
So you have two, three rings and you know your lens is centered or not centered. Yeah.
That's very true. Now, this is, if you can have the camera view.
Yeah, we have the we have the surgical microscope view, sir.
Okay, then. So I'll start with the, is the view okay or is it too magnified?
Crystal clear, sir.
Sir, it's much clearer than what you can see under the microscope.
Oh, thank
because
you.
Because it's magnified, so.
Light to dekhte roj. Good. So the side ports, two side ports made. We move on to the viscoelastic. I go to the other end so that there are no toothpaste like segments seen, and you have an absolutely uniform fill with viscoelastic.
Whole aqueous being replaced.
And then go on to the capsulotomy.
So the second instrument that you have in hand is different, just to stabilize the globe, the second one through the side port?
I call it anchor. We call it an anchor. It is just a plain instrument.
Okay.
Just plain instrument, and it stabilizes. I don't have to use forceps to hold the eye. It gives me a complete stability, and I use it for making the capsulotomy and also for making the main incision. It's a very, very, very practical instrument. So we have done the capsulotomy.
So does it have a femtolaser attached to it? Because we can see the rexus. Looks like a femtorexus.
So the main incision. You can see the single sweep of the fluid.
Yes, sir.
And then it's a very soft nucleus.
I think most of the steroid-induced cataracts are generally soft, and at that age, which is 35 years, then they would be on the softer side.
What's your preferred method, sir, for soft cataracts?
So what technique do you use for soft cataracts?
Now, this case, most of the nucleus is bulged out once I did the hydrodelineation. So this is not possible to chop this nucleus.
I know.
Yeah.
So I'll just aspirate it.
Okay, so that was a very controlled aspiration, actually.
Yeah.
It becomes very difficult to do with the phaco probe the way you are demonstrating, but it is looking very controlled, because at times soft cataract, you know, because of cheese wiring, is a more difficult proposition than a hard cataract.
They are, I agree with you, they are more difficult, but then this is the situation where the fluidics of the machine come to your rescue.
Very, very controlled, without any surge and without any abrupt movements. It just, you know, it just came very swiftly. What, which company probes are these, sir? Irrigation aspiration, because you don't have to increase the size of your side port. They just snugly fit into the side ports that had been previously created.
This is the Duet.
Okay.
From MST. Yes. The iris was coming into this incision, so I have pushed it back, and then I go with the removal of the cortex. And it is important that once you engage, don't make a radial movement, always make a circumferential movement like this.
And is this aspiration probe also, is it diamond dusted for removing cells?
It's diamond dusted, so you can use it as a polisher also.
Yes.
This is actually a very good tip, that what you do is that you don't push the haptic too much on the optics, so that they don't touch each other. Otherwise,
they don't touch each other, they don't stick to each other, and the lens opens a little more quickly.
Yeah. Now you are putting heel on.
Yeah, this is heel on. Now I think we can move on to the Callisto view.
The external camera, please?
Yeah. Is it visible now?
Yes.
Yeah. You can see the three blue lines?
Yeah, yes. Perfect.
So this is the gross rotation, and I'll do it before the lens opens up. Keep it close to where I finally want it, a little anti-clock to that. Wait for a minute.
So what instrument you were using to rotate your lens? It was not Sinsky. It had a ball shape.
It is a collar stud instrument.
Is it Lester? I thought it was Lester.
Yeah, this is the one. It's a collar stud button. Can you see it? Okay,
yes,
I'll show it later, because at this moment. So now the IOL has opened. So I'll go with removing the viscoelastic. Go in, press the lens so that it doesn't rotate. And while pressing the lens, press the foot switch. Since it is heel on, it'll all come as a single bolus dose and come out.
Now, in the first case, even in this case, we saw that the pupil was quite well dilated and you could see the marks. What if the pupil constricts in between? Then, and you can't see where the marks are.
If the pupil is dilated and it constricts during surgery, then I'll use the intracameral xylocard and adrenaline mixture, and it dilates quickly.
Okay.
If the pupil is not dilating beforehand, it's a very small pupil, then you have to take a decision whether you will be attempting a toric or not in that case.
So we have three lines which you can see which are, going to be aligned on the mark. So I think it is in the central line that you would try to align.
Now I'm... Can you see the pupil dilating now?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So I had just injected intracameral.
Yeah, now we can see the pupil. We
now
can
it
see
is beautifully dilated. Yes.
I think that was a good trick to show us that in case there is an intraop meiosis, then how to deal with it, especially when it is so important for toric IOLs. Sometimes what happens is, I don't know, Rajesh, if you've seen that you try to align one and the other one doesn't align.
Yes, yeah. Then average out the two.
Yeah, then in those instances, so, what do you do?
Average out the two.
Because of the parallax, it will come on one side.
Parallax, because of the head tilt, sometimes you can have this.
So now it is aligned.
Yes.
And now I'll reform the anterior chamber and wait for a little time to make sure that there is no leakage of the wound.
Do you need to put pilocarpine? Would you advocate pilocarpine at the end of the surgery, or it doesn't matter? I mean, you can leave it like this.
Good question. I would avoid pilocarpine, because you don't know at what step in the surgery the lens can move.
Yeah.
And I don't want that after I have made the wound tight, I don't want to go into the incision again to inject pilocarpine. How is the trans- transmission. Is it clear? Can you see
this? Very clear.
Very clear.
Very, very
can you see these particles, fine particles in the, aqueous?
Yes, yes.
We thought probably these are tiny bubbles or...
So I look at the pattern of these moving particles. Now at this moment, these particles are stationary.
Yeah.
So if I find that these particles are moving towards one of the incision, that means I need to hydrate that incision. Now the particles are moving towards the main incision. So I haven't hydrated it. We didn't hydrate it in the first case. This is a young person with the scleral rigidity a little less. So I would like to hydrate it and then again check, reform it, and then again study the pattern of these particles. They should be stationary. They should not be moving towards any of the wounds.
I think, again, that's a very useful tip. Something that even I have learned new today, that, you know, you have to see the movement of the particles. It's a very good tip.
It means the fluid is not moving towards the...
it is a very good tip.
So now they are, the particles are stable. So that means there's no leakage of the wound. So that will be the end of the surgery. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Wonderful.
Can we have the mic? Do you want to have a look at the... Can we have the microscope? Yes. Show me the instrument also.
Can we have the microscope view, please?
So this is the microscope view now.
Yes. Very clear and very nicely seen.
And this is the tip of the instrument. The dialer.
Yes. So, can we have the background of the next case?
Yeah, the next case we'll be demonstrating the LRIs. So we'll be moving on to the femto second laser.
So your femto OR must be different from your...
Yes, femto is different. And
which machine are we using, sir?
Catalyst. We have the catalyst. You can take the camera there. And all the I do all the FECO part and all the femto. So Taj does it, so he'll be doing this. We are now moving on to the other OT.
So Rajesh, you worked on both Verion and Callisto. So which one do you think is better, and what do you think are the differences between the two?
Actually, both are good, and even the manual marking works well if it is done properly. And I guess Toric IOL is a little forgiving, even if you are 1 or 2 degrees, 2-3 degrees off axis.
It doesn't make
too much of a difference. So that way, I mean, most of these systems, they work well as far as alignment of Toric IOL is concerned.
Now, these are the parameters. If we go to the... this is the general information. We'll be doing capsulotomy, nucleotomy, and LRI. This is a 5.5 millimeter capsulotomy. And it is circular and centered onto the pupil. These are the different parameters. Incision depth 600 micron, horizontal spot 5, vertical spacing 12 micron, and energy 4. And these are the settings for the lens fragmentation. We'll be dividing into 6 fragments and not doing softening. And this is the LRI, which is again centered onto the pupil. And this is the axis, the optical zone, and the length is 45 degrees. The patient has a preoperative...
Sir, when do you decide you have to do softening in a case or you don't require it? Do you do it for particular kind of morphology of cataracts?
Good question, ma'am. Now, if you look at the lens thickness, if the lens is very thick, it's going to take a long time. It may take 90 seconds or so. If the lens is soft, then also you don't need to do any softening. So there's no need to do a softening in a very soft cataract. I'll also avoid doing softening in a very hard cataract. This is again contrary to what most of the people will say. In a hard cataract, I would prefer to divide it into 8 fragments, and I would use the very high energy, and I'll use 5 to 6 passes so that I divide them into, and then the good phaco machine eats them away. So the most difficult thing in a hard cataract is to divide them into segments. So I'll prefer to divide the segment with the femto and then use the phaco to it.
So even if, sir, do you mean that even if the femto doesn't divide fully, it becomes easier to chop in those lines, along those lines?
It is easier to chop, but once you titrate the settings and you increase the number, normally we do 3 passes. Here we'll go on to 6 passes. The spacing will reduce the spacing also, and you'll be able to separate them comfortably. It becomes very easy later on.
So that is the docking now going on? So now it is doing the OCT, and we'll soon see the image of the cornea. Here you have the image of the cornea and the surface mark, and then you have the lens. You have the posterior lens delineated, and it has picked up all the surfaces accurately, and it is showing the pupil diameter 6.8, and it is showing the lens thickness 5.4, the 4.3, and once it is okay, you go to the next step. And in that, it will show you the markings. These are the markings for the capsulotomy. These are the nucleotomy, and this is marking the So that is the capsulotomy being done. It takes about 0.6 to 0.7 seconds. And then you can see the radionucleotomy lines and this white wave that you are seeing. This you will see in a cataract, which is intermediate cataract. In soft cataract, we'll just see tiny dots along the incision lines.
Can you see me now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Hello, is the sound?
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. Perfectly.
Hello, is the audio audible?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. So now what we have done is that we have completed the femto part. We have done a capsulotomy, which is centered onto the pupil. We have divided the nucleus. And we have also done the LRI to control the astigmatism. Now the patient will be shifted here. So we have a couple of minutes if there are any questions.
So we do have many questions actually. Just talking about the capsulotomy that you just now did with femto, it takes about 0.6 to 0.7 seconds?
Yes.
So there is the advantage in white cataracts wherein we can have a complete capsulotomy before anything leaks out to obstruct the capsulotomy, and we can have a complete capsulotomy in white cataracts with this system.
In white cataract, we have a separate setting for doing a capsulotomy, where the spacing is little less. And then in this case, the height of the cylinder that where the laser fires was 600 micron.
Yes.
In soft cataract or in white cataract, we will make it to 1000 or 1100 millimeters. So because it is always going to puncture at one point, even if it is at a very high speed. So once it punctures and the fluid leaks out, then the configuration of the capsule changes.
It's going to go down.
Absolutely.
To take care of that little movement that may take place in the capsule, it's advisable to keep the cylinder height at 1000 or 1100 microns, so that even if the capsule moves, it still remains within that cylinder and you get a complete capsulotomy.
Absolutely. So very nice tips. Mm-hmm. Wonderful.
So there's a question, and Dr. Ramanpreet wants to know how important it is to remove the viscoelastic from behind the lens for toric IOLs, because when you're removing from behind the lens from toric, then there's every possibility that it'll move like you do in monofocal. I mean, non-toric lenses, you can do it, but do you think it's advisable to do it or it's not required?
The answer to that is yes. And if the second part of the question is how, then the answer to that is use Helon. It is cohesive. When you pull it out, it comes completely. You notice that I didn't have to go around like this with the IA tape to remove it from different places. You press the lens, keep it at one point, and because of the elasticity of coherence, the whole of it will come as single lot. If you're using Helon, you don't have to worry whether something is left behind the implant or not.
So there's a question that will axis marking after completing phaco and before IOL insertion make any difference?
I would prefer to, at that stage of surgery, I would prefer to have my focus on the surgical steps. I would prefer to finish the marking before I start the surgery.
And when the eye has not been opened up, the configuration is absolutely fine.
Absolutely.
I mean, marking will be better during that. And there's another question from Dr. Riddhi, and she wants to know what about the role of torics in developmental cataracts in children?
Good question. At what age we are thinking that? What is the age of the patient where we are operating? If it is a very young baby, I don't think you'll be doing a toric in those cases. Once the cornea has developed and the eye has developed, and you are sure that the refractive power is going to be stable after this age, then of course I would think of a toric implant, because in infants or 2 years old, anyway, you're not getting the accurate refractive power. The per patient is anyway going to use glasses. So the objective of torics is more chances, greater probability of giving a spectacle-free distant vision.
And what is the ideal size of capsulorhexis what size would you prefer during your toric lens implantation?
5.5.
So Dr. Ankit wants to know, how much helpful is Varion marking than manual marking, and will it make a difference? Have you seen a difference between the manual marking and the...
Yes. The first main difference between Varion or Callisto and the manual marking is the convenience. Number two, for the surgeon, it is just like doing any other surgery. For me, there are no additional steps. The IOL master is done by the staff who is doing the biometry. The readings are entered into the system in the OT by the OT staff. And I have to just focus the microscope, rest of the things they are doing. So it makes my job very easy. Now, the second is accuracy. We have done a number of cases where we have done manual marking and then taken to the Callisto. In most of the cases, you'll be within 5 to 7 degrees. There are very few cases that will be exactly dead right. So it is not that important also to have the Callisto. It also means that if you don't have Callisto, you can't do toric implant. That is also wrong. If you can do a little practice, do the manual marking. The marker that we are using is, can I have the marker for that? The marker that we are using is not the third one, the beach seeker. No, third piece. I'll just give me half a minute. I'll just show you the one which we are using.
I think that's a very balanced view, because although we do have these sophisticated systems, but even with a manual, you obtain nearly the same results. And I think there are a lot of meta-analysis and studies also which says, you know, pretty much the same. Yes, sir.
Can you zoom onto this, please? Now, that is the instrument I'm using. Okay. Now, this will always remain in the... It has a pendulum, and it will always remain exactly horizontal. So you don't have to worry about whether your horizontal position is correct or not. And then it has four, it gives you four marks. Can you see there are four marks onto it.
Yeah.
And then it has two rings. Now the two rings are to align the limbus exactly around it. So in this, you will be able to align it exactly at the limbus, and you have four marks coming, so that if one of them is not dark enough, you have at least 3 points on which you can refer. And this is what gives you exactly horizontal position. So all you need to do is make sure the patient's head is straight and head is not tilted, and the chin is the forehead is a little down, so that this part doesn't touch the cheek of the patient. So the marking with this is very easy, accurate, and it will give you exactly correct axis. And if you don't have a Callisto, it should not deter you from doing the toric lenses.
So just to reduce the human error, you have to be extra careful, and you can get very good results even
Dr. Jesh, another thing I would like to, I don't have the at this moment the videos with me. A Callisto is not foolproof. That is one thing.
Yeah.
I always will have my a little bit of judgment that where the axis should be horizontal. And sometimes Callisto may go off by 10 degrees, 15 degrees. And in that situation, I'll ask it to do it again. We do it again, and then we get it right. So first Callisto, you have to somehow manually make sure that it's picking up it correctly.
So can we have the case? Are we ready?
We have the case ready.
Okay, sir.
So I'll just drape. And
yes. And if you don't have, I think even for centration of the lens, you don't need those rings. You can always ask the patient to center and see those three Purkinje images, and if they are in the center of the lens, exactly.
It can also be used as a guide to do a capsulotomy, and it can also be used as a guide for the incision, to put exactly incision, especially if you're trying to correct a little bit of astigmatism by making incision at the steeper axis.
What about your experience with lenses which are multifocal and toric both, or say EDOF toric lens or a trifocal toric lens?
As I had said earlier, that it's very important to control astigmatism in multifocal lenses. So if this astigmatism is less than one diopter, then I'll do the femto. If it is one or more than one, then I'll go in for a toric multifocal.
So what lens would you be using here in this case? Will it be multifocal toric or a plain toric lens?
This is here we have done the we have corrected the astigmatism with LRI.
So
we are using the Technis 1 iTech.
Okay. And there's a question by Dr. Shravan. As a beginner, what astigmatism power we should start with using these toric lenses?
What is generally recommended?
One or more than one.
Yeah.
You can shift on to the microscope view now. Niche dekhlo.
So based on your femto LRI's experience, what do you think is the predictability of these LRI's?
Not as good as a toric implant.
Yeah.
I think we had done a study where we had compared this with the LRI's and found toric, in terms of contrast sensitivity and in terms of quality of vision, the toric lenses were better than the LRI's.
So you can, the microscope view is with you, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So, sir, you don't make incisions with the femto?
No. Those incisions are clear corneal incisions. Now, in this case, if you see, the cornea here is not clear.
If you
try to make the incisions in occipitals, you will have a very miserable experience.
And of course, in such cases of femto, one can't do a very vigorous hydro procedure.
No.
Do you try to remove some bubbles which are trapped in between the incisions or
behind the lens?
Behind the lens.
I did try to rock it a little bit, if you noticed. I did like this, nothing came. So I will not make any further attempt. So they'll come out once we divide it. That's the time they'll come out.
Yeah.
And as we had seen at the time of the femto, it was spreading as a thin sheet between the layers.
Mm-hmm.
So in these cases, you may not have bubbles that you can rock out. And the chopper that I'm using, this is the Rosen 60 degree chopper, where the tip of the chopper is not in line with the handle. The tip is in line with the phaco tip. Because when you do it, your movements are towards the phaco probe like this. So that is when the bubbles come out.
Yeah. Mm.
You see, the piece is almost lying free. I didn't have to do anything to take it out. And coming to the same question of softening, I would like to use the same energy to divide it rather than use that energy to partly divide it and partly fragment it.
When do you use the frag pattern, sir? Any specific indication?
For
frag pattern.
When do you soften the cataract? So which situations would you use the softening?
No, I do. I think for the last 6 or 8 months, we are very few cases we are softening them.
It always works well when you divide the nucleus into multiple pieces and aspirate out easily.
Yeah, those pieces at times, if you have very small pieces, they create more problems.
Yeah.
So I think femto makes a lot of difference, maybe not for routine cases, but for complex cases like posterior polar, like subluxated, like white cataracts.
Yeah.
And of course, It helps previously operated cases.
And multifocal cases.
Yeah, multifocal because it just helps you to put your X's in the center.
Yeah. And you can make a 5.5, 5.7 capsulotomy, which is centered and still have the edge of the capsulotomy covering the lens all around.
And I think this step gets a little more difficult as compared to the normal step because the fibers, they get cut and then you have to really fetch them from within the capsular fornices to get them out.
So especially in femto cataract surgery, bimanual is really very useful in taking out the subincisional cortex.
Yeah, that is in femto cataract, I'll always use a bimanual. For IA and for removing the visco, I'll again go to coaxial.
Okay.
So any experience with the smart toric IOL, sir, where 0-180, all toricity is at 0-180 only and you don't have to rotate it at all?
Where they all the lenses you have, you see, the issue is having the inventory and the waiting time that you will have. And I don't see any advantage, and I am fairly convinced that anyone who will be doing toric is doing at a level of a proficiency where it will not be a problem for him to rotate the lens. It looks difficult that rotating the lens will be difficult, but believe me, it's so easy. And you can get a hang of it in just few cases.
And so even in those cases, you have to maintain it at 0 and 180.
Yeah.
So it's sort of a rotation only, that you have to maintain it at 0 180 degree. You have to bring it to 0 180 degree. So you will open up the LRI after implanting the IOL?
Okay, good question. The answer is no. I'll tell you why. I'll just insert the lens and come to that.
So we also noticed that you've already marked 0-180 here with a gentian violet or whatever. I mean, that mark is
These are the markings done for the femto to align the LOI exactly with the horizontal axis, so that your LRI comes to a correct axis.
Okay.
And this will be done for all femto cases where the LRI is to be done. So you see, the lens is rotating because I didn't press it this time. In toric, I was pressing the lens. If I press the lens, it will not move.
Yeah.
So in toric, this is what is to be done. Pillow. In this case, I'll be using pilocarpine.
Reason for that, sir? Reason for putting pilocarpine?
You want an honest answer?
Yeah. You all want to learn from you, sir. So, an honest answer.
I feel that once the patient goes home in half an hour or so, the pupil will be constricted. He'll be more comfortable. He'll have less glare. In the post-op period,
he'll see better.
Besides pulling out from the angle, which is not otherwise also in a surgery like this, there's not an issue of the iris or the angle.
Yeah.
But patient is more comfortable in the immediate post-op period.
So why didn't you open the LRI, sir?
Because when I started, I was doing the anterior penetrating LRIs, and we did have some situations and some issues where we were having some problem. It was not very comfortable for the patient. Some patients would complain of irritation from the incision for some time. One of the cases has a little epithelial defect. One of the patients was using mask at night for sleep apnea. And as you know, these people don't clean their masks. So they put it every day, same mask every day. So one of the patients developed a little bit of keratitis around that because of that. So now I'm doing intrastromal. So in intrastromal, you don't have to open it up. But intrastromal, once you do intrastromal, you leave about 15% anterior, 15% posterior intact. And when you're doing the loader, there are gas bubbles formed. Now, those bubbles will open up. If you had noticed in this case, the LRI was boat-shaped. It was not a thin line. So those, the gases, they open up it. So you don't have to open it. So I do intrastromal.
Okay. So that is why you don't require to open it.
And does it have the same effect?
Sorry, can you repeat, sir, question?
Does it have the same effect, sir, intrastromal LRI?
No, it's a little less effect than that.
Less effect.
But then a positive thing is that there is no scarring also in this.
And the patient is not symptomatic.
And the risk of the open wound and all those things are taken care of. Although it may occur once in 2 years or once in 1 year, but if it occurs, it's not something which you would like your cases to be with.
Sir, what is your toric practice in general? How many percentage of the cases you would be doing toric IOL implantation?
I will not have the exact stats, but I'll say 30% or 20-30%. Because very low threshold for corneal astigmatism. I would like to correct it. And it's very rewarding. It's very, very rewarding.
We all have felt that, you know, toric IOLs are a bit forgiving. I mean, a few degrees off, still the patient has good vision and good clarity.
Absolutely.
And perhaps that's the reason why we have so many things to mark the axis. And it may differ like 1 or 2 degrees here and there, but both will have almost similar results.
Now, as a standard protocol, when the toric patients come at 2 weeks follow-up, I'll dilate all those cases and confirm the axis on the slit lamp. And whatever reading is coming, I'll mark it on the same page where the original printout you have. And it comes absolutely fine. You hardly have any variations at 2 weeks also, compared to what you had at the end of the surgery. There's no need to dilate the pupil before 2 weeks. A rough parameter that your axis is fine is the visual acuity on day one. If the patient is 6-6 on day one, you don't need to check the axis on day one. But 2 weeks is a standard protocol.
And if you need to rotate, then what is your cutoff for rotation of the...
Then 2 weeks, next day after the 2 week visit, I'll rotate it.
You'll rotate.
Then not wait. Then again, very low threshold on rotation. Then I'll not try to see if this patient will manage with this, or I'll not try to see if this patient doesn't mind glasses. Again, very low threshold for that. If the axis is not right, go and correct it. And it's again very easy. I have a side port anchor. It is a similar instrument like this, but it is irrigating. And it has the edge is such that it fits onto the limbus. So all you do is you put it to the bottle, just go in, it reforms the anterior chamber, and through the other side port you go and dilate it. You don't have to even use a viscoelastic.
And anything to guide the amount of rotation, like some people use Zaldivar caliper and eye trace, and anything that you would prefer?
Can you repeat, sir, the question?
I mean, some people do use these Zaldivar caliper and eye trace.
Use eye trace to, get the correct axis or how much rotation is
required.
If the patient comes with the wrong axis in the post-op period?
Yes. So yes, how would you gauge that, and do you use eye trace for that?
Go to the fixastigmatism.com and follow it.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for that wonderful demonstration.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving me this chance to be with the audience. Thank you so much.
It was a great honor interacting with you. We always love to do it.
Yeah.
And it was an opportunity for us and for so many people to, you know, see your surgeries and, you know, peep into your operation theater.
Sitting at home without having to actually go there.
Yeah.
I think that is the best thing I like about the surgery now. It's a fantastic way to connect people and at their convenience.
Yeah, absolutely. And without traveling from here to there. And
I must congratulate you, Namrata Madam, for initiating it and continuing with this.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And we would also like to thank our sponsors here at this point in time, the Johnson & Johnson team, who does it each time with the equally or even better efficiency. They get better with each surgeon hour. And this time, the backdrop that they have at your place is just looking fantastic. And also Manish, who coordinates from the headquarters. So thank you so much, sir. We also learned so many new tips. And the best part is that this is a purely educational exercise. So there's no, you know, hurry of just finishing a case in 5 minutes or 7 minutes as you go in a conference, or you have to talk about the IOL or about the machine. all the finer details and the points are you so well highlighted, like the movement of the particles, the loading of the lens, and each one of them, I think they are beautiful tips. And sometimes you just go through the pages of a book, or you go through, you know, the videos, and you can't pick up unless somebody just tells you what exactly to see and what exactly
this
to do.
This is after loads of experience. Yeah. So. Thank you so much,
and have a great evening. Thank you, sir.
And everybody who's on the Facebook Live, there are so many viewers who are viewing you, as well as the logins. They're all congratulating you for a great session, sir. Thank you so much.
Thanks to Sartaj for
managing behind the scenes.
Yeah, can we see him?
Where is he? Call him. I think he has gone down now. Thank you so much. He's been a big support.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much.